This is obviously quite an elaborate program we have today, so I've promised Helmut that I would run an incredibly tight ship, so forgive me if I'm a bit draconian. It's all in the interest of making sure everyone has their allotted time. Professor Brandom is Distinguished Professor of Philosophy at the University of Pittsburgh. He is, of course, one of the leading philosophers in the world, a towering figure whose work has been immensely influential, indeed agenda-setting, in the philosophy of language, philosophy of mind, logic, pragmatism, etc. He's author of such landmark works as Making It Explicit, Articulating Reasons, Between Saying and Doing, just to name a few. And he's delivered many of the most prestigious lectures in the field, including the John Locke Lectures in 2006 and the Aquinas Lectures I heard just last year. But in the course of advancing his own incredibly ambitious systematic program, Professor Brandom has arguably done more than perhaps any other analytic philosopher to revive and reanimate the central ideas of German idealism, especially Hegel. A Spirit of Trust is by every measure a truly monumental work. So I would like to welcome Professor Brandom and thank him again for participating in this event, which is really, I think, an incredibly special one. So we're honored to have you here.
In A Spirit of Trust, I deciphered the metavocabulary that Hegel develops in the Phenomenology, the language that he uses to enable us to talk and think about discursive practice, the use of ground-level empirical and practical concepts. Sprache, he tells us, language, is the Dasein of Geist, what the book is a phenomenology of. And I read him as offering a broadly pragmatist theory of meaning in terms of use. His pragmatics of rationality is structured by dual social and historical axes. He understands the normativity of discursive practice as instituted socially by practical attitudes of reciprocal recognition. He understands the semantic determinate contentfulness of concepts in terms of the pragmatic activity of retrospectively, recollectively, rationally reconstructing their actual applications so as to give such contingent sequences of doings the shape of expressively progressive traditions, what he calls turning a past into a history. That's revealing them as the gradual emergence into explicitness of norms that show up as having all along implicitly governed the process of applying the concepts. As I read him, on the ground floor of his intellectual edifice is a non-psychological conception of the conceptual. This is the idea that to be conceptually contentful is to stand in relations of material incompatibility and consequence, his determinate negation and mediation, to other such contentful items. The relations of incompatibility and consequence are denominated material to indicate that they articulate the contents rather than the form of what stands in those relations. This is his first and most basic semantic idea, an understanding of conceptual content in terms of modally robust relations of exclusion and inclusion. This understanding of the conceptual is deeply hylomorphic. Conceptual contents, understood as roles with respect to relations of material incompatibility and consequence, are amphibious. They show up in two different forms. They have a subjective form and an objective form. The subjective form articulates what these things are or can be for consciousness, and the objective form articulates what they are or can be in themselves. The second is the form of empirical reality. The first is the form in which empirical reality appears to knowing subjects. On the side of thought, these are deontic normative constraints. One subject ought not to have incompatible empirical and practical commitments and ought to acknowledge the consequences of those she does acknowledge. On the side of being, though, these are alethic modal constraints. One object cannot have incompatible properties and necessarily has the properties that follow from its other properties. They're related as the two poles of the intentional nexus, what can be known and the attempted knowing of it, noumena and phenomena. Subjectivity and objectivity are both conceptually articulated, and the same conceptual content can show up both in the subjective normative form of thoughts and in the objective modal form of states of affairs. Genuine knowledge occurs when one and the same content shows up in both different forms, the subjective form of thought and the objective form of fact. I call this view bimodal hylomorphic conceptual realism. Hegel's second semantic idea is a consequence of the hylomorphic development of the first. That is, that these two forms of conceptual content stand to one another in representational relations, as subjective representings of reality and the objective realities represented. These two dimensions of semantic contentfulness, the conceptual and the representational, can be thought of as the Hegelian forms of the Frege'ian meta-concepts of sense and reference, Sinn and Bedeutung, thoughts and what thoughts are about, what can be expressed and what can be represented. And Hegel's semantic explanatory strategy is to explain the second representational dimension of conceptual contentfulness in terms of the first expressive dimension. What it is to represent something is to be understood in terms of relations among conceptual contents. The idea of a noumenal reality is to be explained in terms of how phenomenal appearances point beyond themselves in virtue of their relations to one another. The semantic relations between these two forms of conceptual contents are understood in the pragmatic context of processes and practices of intentional agency. Reason, he says, is purpose of agency. Regarded prospectively, practical agency is the experience of coping with cognitive error and practical failure. Regarded retrospectively, it's reconstructed by the exercise of recollective rationality as the actualization and determination of a governing intention, which both provides standards for assessments of correctness and success on the deontic normative side of the knowing subject, and to which the process is subjunctively sensitive on the alethic modal side of the known object. Hegel explains the representational semantic dimension of conceptual contents, relations between thoughts and things, phenomena and noumena, appearance and reality, in terms of the essentially temporally biperspectival pragmatics of rational agency. The historical process by which conceptual contents are determined, prospectively made and retrospectively found, exhibits the structure of coordinate, reciprocal authority and responsibility, characteristic of the institution of normative statuses by mutual recognitive attitudes. It's a social recognitive process. The normative pragmatics explains the interrelations of the inferential, social, and historical holisms characteristic of Hegel's semantics. Recollective rationality is also the key both to understanding the history of Geist, which I take to be all our norm-governed practices and performances, and the status, selves, and institutions that they produce and are produced by, and to envisaging its next development. For Hegel, the turning point of history so far, just the biggest thing that ever happened to us, has been the gradual, still incomplete transition from traditional to modern forms of life. This was a shift from a metaphysics of normativity structured by the status dependence of normative attitudes to one structured by the attitude dependence of normative statuses. The mistake characteristic of traditional forms of life is fetishism, mistaking what are in fact the products of our activities for objective features of the world. Modernity is the advent of a distinctive kind of normative self-consciousness of our own role in instituting norms. The pathology characteristic of modernity is alienation from the norms that make us what we are, failure to understand them practically as rationally constraining on us. When recognition takes the form of retrospective, rational, reconstructive recollection, the insights of traditional practical and modern theoretical normative self-consciousness will be reconciled and their failures overcome. We'll move decisively beyond the normative structure of subordination and obedience to genuine self-conscious freedom, Geist with the structure of trust. That's the story I think he tells in the Phenomenology.
I introduce our first critic, Mark Alsenauer, who is associate professor in the Department of Philosophy at Northwestern University. He specializes in ethics, aesthetics, and social theory in 19th century European philosophy. He's vice president of the Hegel Society.
Was
vice president of the Hegel Society of North America, and he's author of Hegel's Theory of Responsibility, published by Cambridge in 2015.
In Mark Twain's autobiography, he talks a little bit about what it was like to improvise stories to his two daughters in their home in Hartford. And you have to think that he was pretty good at this, but he complains that his daughters, they put like a constraint on what kinds of stories he was allowed to tell. Every story had to incorporate each of the knickknacks that were on the mantle in the library. And he always had to start in the same place with this picture of, I think there was a cat on the left, and he had to go through all of the knickknacks and end with the portrait of the young girl on the far right. Anyone offering a new interpretation of the phenomenology of spirit faces a similarly challenging task. So given the long-standing interpretive debates surrounding the book, there's always room for a new reading. But any such reading has to touch on every chapter and in the right order. One of the most impressive things about Robert Brandom's A Spirit of Trust is that it manages to offer a reading of the phenomenology that honors this constraint, despite starting with an utterly unprecedented claim about what the whole book is about. He does skip a few things and he doesn't quite make it to the end, but you can't fail to admire how much of the phenomenology he proved capable of digesting and putting in the service of what is, by all appearances, an entirely new problematic, a semantic question about the conditions for the possibility of conceptual content. Now, once it's shown that this is the problem Hegel was addressing, we are off to the races. Brandom shows in a tour de force that you can plausibly read the entire phenomenology as a chain of transcendental arguments leading to a striking conclusion of insidious intent. That once we understand all that is required for conceptual content to be determinate, we will see the need to adopt new recognitive relations to each other, thus ushering in a new postmodern age. Now, Brandom suggests that his focus on the semantic content of ordinary concepts is mainly a matter of emphasizing something other readers have not attended to, something maybe orthogonal to their interests. But I think this significantly undersells Brandom's originality, or so I will argue here. So Brandom is not just bringing out something underdeveloped in other accounts. I think he's overturning previous understandings of how Hegel's project relates to the semantics of ordinary concepts. So by showing how this account relates to some alternative accounts in the tradition of Hegel reception, I hope to bring out both what's most sort of revolutionary or paradigm shifting in Brandom's reading, and also to reveal what might be like some exegetical and philosophic costs that attend the attempted revolution. So maybe putting a little pressure on him to justify his heterodoxy. So before I get to those sort of contrast cases, I want to get a better idea of what Brandom understands as the central issue. So Brandom fully recognizes that the traditional way of reading Hegel is to focus on his derivation of specifically philosophical concepts, like in the phenomenology, consciousness, self-consciousness, and agency. This focus is completely natural because Hegel himself spends most of his time discussing and developing these philosophical concepts. But Brandom argues that the function of these philosophical concepts is to express key features of the way we use ordinary empirical and practical concepts, concepts like blue, stick, or straight. And if that's the right way to understand philosophical concepts, that is, to understand them as meta-concepts, then it's plausible to think that the best way to understand these notions is not to study them on their own, which is mostly what we've been doing, but to keep our eye on their implications for ordinary ground-level concept use. Now, Brandom calls this interpretive strategy semantic descent. Every time he encounters sort of like a high-level philosophic concept in Hegel's writing, he's going to read it as a notion meant to express or describe how ordinary lower-level concepts work. And he's going to do this even if the surrounding passage doesn't give any clear indication of this. The eventual payoff of this strategy is that it allows us to see how Hegel anticipated Brandom's own pragmatic inferentialism about ordinary concepts. On this view, ordinary concepts are not to be understood as having content on their own, a content which would then explain the use we make of them in judgments and inferences, as a representationalist might claim. Instead, we find out that such concepts get their content from the inferences that are made with them, which themselves depend on certain practices, and so on and so forth. So semantic descent has the real merit of making Hegel's most obscure claims more tractable, more intelligible, and not least, I think, more relevant to contemporary philosophical discussions. So insofar as contemporary philosophers are concerned with concepts at all, they are almost exclusively concerned with ordinary concepts. The characteristically Kantian and post-Kantian concern with the systematic deduction of a full set of pure philosophical concepts has had little or no resonance in these conversations. But on Brandom's reading, the appearances are all misleading. Hegel is not, he's not only addressing the same phenomena the contemporary philosopher of language is interested in, that is to say, ordinary concepts, he also has a radically innovative view of how they get their semantic content. So it's the important question, the one I want to raise, is whether Brandom can convince us that Hegel's philosophical concepts can be read as meta-concepts, as concepts that are intended to serve, or intended to express the way ordinary concepts function. And you're going to have to read the book to see his full account of this and see if you're convinced. But let me say that I don't think the issue is easy to decide on purely textual grounds. Hegel does not say much about ordinary concepts, either in the phenomenology or elsewhere. And when he does speak of them, he usually insists that they are defective in some way. So he'll say that compared to the concept, ordinary representations are abstract or finite, and most often that they're untrue in his specific technical sense. Now, this could be a sign, as I think somebody in a Brandomian might argue, that Hegel rejects representationalist views of conceptual content and is on the way to mounting a defense of some sophisticated form of pragmatic inferentialism, or inferentialism in general. But I'm just going to end by contrasting this view with three other ways of understanding what Hegel means by criticizing ordinary concepts or abstract representations. On the most traditional interpretation of Hegel, one that goes back at least to Kuno Fischer, ordinary concepts presuppose philosophical concepts, not because the latter express how the former function, but because no thought is possible at all without pure concepts. So when Hegel says in the Encyclopedia that the proposition, this leaf is green, presupposes philosophic concepts like being and singularity, he is not denying that ordinary concepts like leaf and green might very well be partially derived by abstraction from individuals, as on classical representationalist views. He's only insisting that the content of empirical concepts also implicitly includes concepts whose origin cannot be empirical in that broad sense. Ordinary empirical concepts are untrue, not because they only acquire content in certain practices, as on the Brandomian account, but because they depend on other pure philosophical concepts for their determinacy, and hence they depend on the interrelated set of these concepts, the concept. So on this traditional reading, Hegel has radical and exciting things to say about philosophical concepts. I mean, the logic is the most obvious thing, but he has mostly uninteresting and commonplace things to say about ordinary concepts. My second sort of contrast case is the British idealists, and they give us a different answer to the question of the relation of ordinary and philosophical concepts, a view that in one respect brings them closer to Brandom's picture. For the British idealists, like Brandom, ordinary concepts like, you know, red-haired is Bradley's famous example, are only mistakenly understood as mere abstract universals or mere representations, such that you could understand them without knowing their applications. If we truly understood what it is to be red-haired, for example, we would have to have knowledge of every red-haired person. Now, this, of course, is a different kind of complaint about abstract universals than Brandom's. The problem is not that abstract universals lack all content when considered apart from their use, but that their content is false in the sense of being misleadingly incomplete, falling short of what it is they're trying to comprehend. I mean, the demand that the British idealists made is that concepts need to be concrete. But though the complaints are different, they lead in the same broad direction, to a kind of holism about ordinary concepts, a claim that you can't fully understand one empirical concept without basically understanding everything. And by contrast, on the traditional reading, Hegel's a holist about philosophical concepts, but has little to say about ordinary concepts. A final, putatively more Wittgensteinian view about the relation between ordinary and philosophical concepts in Hegel can be found in the writings of J.N. Findlay. For Findlay, ordinary concepts are perfectly fine on their own as ways of characterizing ordinary objects, but they are inadequate for the job of characterizing what we do when we make ordinary judgments. So in Findlay's view, Hegel's philosophy involves not semantic descent, but semantic ascent, passing from an object language to a novel term in a meta language that we need to make sense of what we are doing in the object language. For example, at the beginning of the phenomenology, Finley thinks we move from this and now to the notion of a universal, which allows us to characterize what we are doing when we apply this and now, namely wielding universals. So like Brandom, he views Hegel's philosophy as oriented to ordinary conceptual use and is offering us a superior understanding of how it is possible. But unlike Brandom, Finley does not think that there's any problem about the content of ordinary concepts. The problem for Finley, I mean, if you even want to call it a problem, is that any use of concepts necessitates an ascent to higher concepts in order to adequately characterize those first-order concepts. That our first-order concepts have content in their ordinary applications is never in question by Finley. In fact, it is taken for granted. So Finley's statement that Hegel finds no contradiction in ordinary arithmetical computation thus stands in like striking contrast to Brandom's claim that Hegel anticipated Kripke's understanding of the rule-following paradox. So these are just three contrasting cases. And in all of them, I think you can see there's a rejection of the central claim that concepts, empirical concepts don't, you might say, have conceptual content on their own. Partly because of the sheer novelty of Brandom's guiding assumption that the phenomenology does concern the semantics of ordinary concepts, Brandom has not engaged extensively with any of these alternative interpretive possibilities. And so mainly what I'm trying to do is sort of situate him in this tradition and invite him to discuss his role in it. So thank you for the opportunity to read this.
Thank you, Mark. This is great. I couldn't ask for a better introduction to our discussion today. Right from the beginning of your well-crafted paper, I admire the Mark Twain analogy. It's indicating some of the formal, I could even say artistic aspirations of the book. It's operating under severe formal constraints, not only addressing each of the portraits and figurines on the shelf of Hegel's text, but also mapping them onto substantial issues in contemporary semantics, in the philosophy of language of the post-Hegelian period, but particularly of the last 100 years, subject to the constraint that each of Hegel's big moves has to be shown to display both an interesting perspective on and to make some substantial contribution to the understanding of those semantic and pragmatic issues. The book is, in this respect, intended as a contribution to a kind of conceptual literary undertaking whose closest antecedents might be in Heidegger rather than in anything in the analytic tradition. In a wonderful essay that Andrew Cutrofello presented at the Eastern APA, he uses Wordsworth as the basis for initial reflections on what I'm trying to do with Hegel here. Also, Mark has focused on the big idea that distinguishes my reading from prior ones, the identification of the topic that Hegel is addressing and the set of concerns that motivate him. And the key to understanding what thematically distinguishes my approach is indeed what I call semantic descent, reading the phenomenology as principally aimed at understanding the semantics and pragmatics of ground-level empirical and practical concepts. So much as the terms semantics and pragmatics, sort of study of meaning, study of use, these are all substantially, I don't know, contemporary terms that are not available in Hegel's time, and people would say, well, because the topics were not addressed. That's a kind of purposeful anachronism. Now, let me say something briefly about two of the issues he raises. First, he says, look, this reading is not just different from standard readings. It's actually in opposition to many of them. I'm not just saying, look, Hegel is also talking about some things that you may not have thought he was talking about. I am substantially claiming that the tradition got him wrong, that they did not understand what the fundamental issue was that he was addressing that was motivating him. And so one thing one might wonder is, well, how is that even possible? I mean, there's a sort of tradition starting with Hegel. How could this, you know, be a secret from this time? And I think actually it's due to historical contingencies, Hegel didn't leave any first-rate students who principally cared about his metaphysics and his logic. They were interested in his social and political philosophy. Well, it was an exciting time. There was a reason for that. But there were no first-rate students who cared about what he took to be the core issues. And then in the middle years of the 19th century, there was a break during which people really did not read Hegel. The study of Hegel had to be recuperated in the late 19th century. I think people basically started over at that point, and that the tradition we inherit is downstream from that starting over. The second issue that Mark introduced, isn't it striking that if the ultimate topic is the use of ground level concepts, that particularly in the phenomenology, Hegel hardly ever talks about them. I mean, they come up in the logic as examples, and particularly when we get to the doctrine of the concept, learn about different kinds of judgments and so on, but there's very little of that in the phenomenology. And I actually disagree with that characterization of the phenomenology. In particular, the consciousness chapters are, as I read them, all about ground level, I mean, explicitly all about ground level concepts. We start off with demonstratives and indexicals in the sense certainty chapter, and the question is, what's the pragmatic stage setting? What do we need to be able to do in order to use these kinds of expressions? And we find that what we need to be able to do to use them is something that's made explicit by the use of sense universals, of observational predicates. We get the discussion of salt, it's being cubical, it's being white, it's being tart. Those are all exhibited as making explicit features of the use that were implicit already in the use of demonstrative expressions. And the discussion then of sense universals shows us that we're committed by using those to make reference to things that are not observable, namely the objects that have these properties. And that leads in the Force and Understanding chapter to a discussion of theoretical concepts. Force, Newtonian force, standing in allegorically for expressions whose circumstances of application are exclusively non-inferential. I mean, it's more of a job of work to see him discussing ground-level concepts as you go on through the book, but he starts off, the book he started off writing under the topic, under the heading of The Science of the Experience of Consciousness, is explicitly about these ground-level concepts. Finally, at the end of his discussion, Mark very usefully invites a compare and contrast exercise with three sub-traditions of reading Hegel. Kuno Fischer, an incredibly important figure, the founder of Neo-Kantianism, the author of the phrase Zurück nach Kant, who not coincidentally was Frege's Kant teacher, emphasizes the way Hegel's conception of his pure concepts is recognizably a successor notion to Kant's categories. Fischer was centered in Kant, but at the heart of his reading of Hegel was seeing Hegel as offering us a different way of thinking about the categories, thinking of them as in a pluralistic way, in a historicized way. Well, that's a lesson that I think is entirely appropriate. Indeed, I think that where at least some of the neo-Kantian followers of Fischer ended up is very close to the Hegel that I'm presenting in the book. It's just they didn't read Hegel that way. They were radically rereading Kant in the way Hegel was radically rereading Kant. And the picture of Hegel that you had in Germany in the late 19th century was so radically different from what they were doing that they didn't recognize it. It was unrecognizable to them as Hegelian. But I embrace this insight of Fisher's. It's just not followed through. Again, Bradley, speaking for the British idealists, sees at the heart of Hegel his semantic holism. That was really the core idea of British idealism. It was largely recoiling from that holism that led particularly Russell, this was less important to Moore, to characterize the fighting faith of analytic philosophy as a recoil from that holism in Hegel. And I think it's took us the better part of 100 years to work our way back to seeing, you know, what was right about semantic holism. Quine in Two Dogmas famously says that meaning is what essence becomes if it's detached from the thing and attached to the word. Bradley in holism was denying the distinction between internal and external relations on the side of the thing, denying the difference between distinction between what was essential and what was accidental. And Quine was explicitly reintroducing this idea, but now as a semantic idea rather than as a metaphysical idea. Of course, I think Hegel thought we didn't need to make that distinction, or rather that was a distinction that we didn't need to take sides on. Is it semantic or is it metaphysical? Findlay is, though not mentioned in the book, as indeed neither of these other figures are, is a particularly interesting example for me. He was actually my teacher as an undergraduate, or anyway, I took a course from him in Wittgenstein, not in Hegel. But he reads Hegel explicitly as doing metalinguistic analysis. He doesn't connect that notion of the metalinguistic with the Fisher insight into Hegel as picking up on Kant's notion of categories. He doesn't see, as my teacher Sellers did in his reading of Carnap, understand Kant's categories already in metalinguistic terms. But if you put that, what Sellers made of Carnap and Kant together with Findlay, you get somewhere very close to the reading that I'm making here. And of course, I'm avowedly reading Hegel as working in a normative, pragmatic metavocabulary in very much the same way that the later Wittgenstein does, understanding the social character of normativity. So I think there's interesting antecedents to the general lineaments of my reading in all three of the figures that Mark so usefully points us to. So thank you so much for that.
Mark, do you want to start? That was as marvelously thorough a response to my comments as I could have wished for. Thank you for engaging with it in such detail and really on a point-by-point basis sort of exploring your relation to these figures. I found that very gratifying. What happens to the thing that everybody else was so interested in, the deduction of the categories, appear like on your account? It looks like you think that was all just unnecessary, and it would seem like you have to have an account as to why Hegel thought it was, and why he was wrong about that. That's like the flip side of this. It's not the Phenomenology Project per se, but I was wondering if you could just say a little bit about what happens to that part of the story.
My reading of Hegel is non-trivially a critical reading. I think that there's a couple of fundamental mistakes that he made. One is that he thought ordinary determinate empirical concepts were like his philosophical speculative categorical concepts in a way that they're not alike. Namely, he thought that in principle, the only way you could convey the content of a ground level concept was by rationally reconstructing a history of its use. And he thought the same thing was true of the categorical concepts. And that's what he does in one way in the Phenomenology and another way in the Science of Logic. But I think that's wrong. I think the metalinguistic role of the categorical concepts gives us another route to understanding their content. because we can understand them in terms of what they let us say about the use of the ground level concepts. There are no concepts that stand to ordinary empirical concepts in the metalinguistic relation, expressive relation, that the categorical concepts stand to the ordinary empirical concepts. So I think one can specify the contents of Hegel's categorical concepts, individuality, universality, and so on, what things are for consciousness, what they are in themselves. I think one can approach them from below by thinking about what different versions of those let us say about the use of ground level concepts. I mean, I'll mention the another critical disagreement that I have with Hegel concerns a way in which he thinks ground level concepts and categorical concepts are different. As I read him, he thinks that the process of determining the contents of empirical concepts and practical concepts is a never-ending process, that it's in principle impossible for us ever to get a set of determinate empirical concepts such that by applying them correctly according to the norms that make them mean what they mean, we won't end up contradicting ourselves by our own lights, won't end up properly undertaking commitments that when we look at them we say, no, these are incompatible given what we mean. So we've got to change our concepts. We obviously don't have things quite right yet. This instability of the determinate concepts is his version of the way in which the immediate overflows any particular conceptualization of it. What shows up in Kant as the inexhaustibility of a sensuous manifold by conceptually articulated judgments, that there's just always more to be said, in Hegel shows up as the instability of anything that we do say about it. But, he thought, categorical concepts, the ones that articulate our semantic and pragmatic self-consciousness, those we can just get right. We can get a fully adequate set of those meta-concepts, ones which will produce absolute self-consciousness in the sense that we will now have the tools to make explicit all the features of our discursive practice. And he thought that, to a first approximation anyway, he had those in the logic. So he thought that there was this huge difference between the ground level concepts and the meta concepts. And I think that's wrong. I think the meta concepts also are unstable, that in principle one can't get a set of them such that they're making everything explicit, or they're capable of making everything explicit about our ground level use, so that we'll never find ourselves saying, no, these are expressively inadequate tools. And I read the development of logic since the science of logic, which has, as maybe the tour de force centerpiece of it, showing the different forms of the syllogism as expressing all the possible relationships of particularity, individuality, and universality, showing, so see, it's a complete set. Well, 80 years later, we discovered this isn't going to handle iterated quantificational inferences. I think that process, you know, we need some more metalinguistic and conceptual machinery here. I think that process is just not going to stop either. So for both of these reasons, I think the deduction of the categories, well, you're only going to get to sort of as far as we've gotten now. It's only going to be a time slice of this developing process of ever greater semantic and pragmatic self-consciousness. And I think the kind of deduction that he worked so hard on isn't necessary because there's another route to it. So in these regards, I'm not reading Hegel merely to interpret what he's saying. I'm reading him looking at the phenomena that he's addressing and what he's saying about it with a critical eye to say, look, here are lessons we can learn from him, and I think there are many that he has by no means merely rediscovered things that, you know, analytic philosophy was already aware of. That's sort of why it's worth reading him. But I think we also are in a position to correct some of the views that he had. So in this regard too, this doesn't purport to be anything like a final reading. Someone else can come in and, you know, place the center of his thought somewhere else and take on board some of the features of it and give up some of the others.
Just a question about the kind of knowledge that meta concepts are and whether they can be properly objective or universal knowledge, in the way some people take Hegel to say that they are eternal in some even unconditional sense, if you build them on empirical concepts, if ground level concepts are first and then the meta concepts are just used to explain ground level concepts or empirical concepts, do you not transfer the subjectivity or the relativity or conditional character of the ground level concepts onto the meta concept?
Well, the meta concepts purport to make explicit what's implicit in any use of, to begin with, demonstratives, where we see, well, you need whatever it is you know by using the demonstrative, you have to be able to hold on to it. It's the first use of recollection. In there, it has to be repeatable, sort of horizontally as well as vertically. Those purport to be constraints on any possible empirical use of concepts. And each one of them is finding in some form something that really is, in that sense, universal and necessary. But the particular form that we put it in, say, at the level of perception itself, we say, well, no, that isn't quite right, and we need to move on from there. And my claim is that process is going to go on indefinitely, and by rights should. It doesn't mean that there isn't permanent progress made, a real lesson learned each time. It's just that process doesn't stop.
Pierre Keller is associate professor of philosophy at the University of California, Riverside. He specializes in Kant, 19th century philosophy, and phenomenology, and is the author of several books, including Kant and the Demands of Self-Consciousness, published by Cambridge University Press.
So I'm going to focus on the connection between conceptual realism in Bob Brandom's account and conceptual idealism. But first, let me say that I find the book, A Spirit of Trust, philosophically exciting, philosophically breathtaking. It's a wonderful traversal through Hegel's phenomenology of spirit. It shows the great insight that I think analytic philosophy at its best can give into classical philosophical texts. However, from my own point of view, it also shows the limitations of contemporary semantic realism. A Spirit of Trust defends realism in a very robust sense. At one point, and there are many passages like this, Bob Brandom says, there could be an objective, conceptually structured world even if there were no subjects applying concepts in inferentially articulated practices, giving and asking for reasons, hence no believers or agents. But there could not be concept users, hence subjects, except in a conceptually structured objective world. So far, this line of thought articulates a common sense realism. That's commonsensical in America, certainly. And it probably in Europe too these days. I'm not sure that Hegel would have endorsed it. It's about the common sense realism about the asymmetrical dependence of subjects on the objective world they inhabit. I believe, so Robert Brandom, Hegel never wavered in his endorsement of his version of this platitudinous view. So on my view, this is not platitudinous. And in fact, I guess I'm tempted to say that on Robert Brandom's reading, there is a three-legged stool to what he calls absolute idealism. One leg of the stool is this conceptual realism. The other legs of the stool are objective idealism, and the third leg is conceptual idealism. Now, I am inclined to think that Hegel thinks that at the very least, objective idealism constitutes the refutation of conceptual realism. So that's where my fundamental disagreement with Brandom centers. From the vantage point of a neo-Fregean conceptual realism, it makes sense to say that there could be an objectively, conceptually structured world without subjects who have concepts. Hegel, in his Science of Logic, introduces his conception of a concept in the introduction to his Begriffslogik in terms of the articulation of Kant's objective unity of apperception and its structural implications. But Kant's objective unity of apperception and its holistic structural grounding rule for the form of judgment is not independent of the subjective unity of apperception in terms of which each one of us relates to the objective structural field of logical and empirically and practically significant relations from the vantage point of our own standpoint and interests and our own idiolect. And so I'm fully on board with the attempt to offer a kind of transcendental reconstruction of the notions of subject and object and ascribing that to Hegel. But on my view, when Hegel does that, he simultaneously deconstructs the very notions of subject and object. And I take Kant already to do that and to Hegel to have seen that. So he deconstructs the foundational role of semantics relative to pragmatics. So I take Kant and Hegel to argue for a conception of subjectivity and objectivity that are fundamentally interwoven and originate together. So you never have subjects or objects without them be co-constituting each other. And they co-constitute each other and the notion of an objective world. So no sense can be given for Kant, except in a very abstract, empty sense of a world independent of our cognition. And I would say for Hegel, no sense at all to that. So from that point of view, I can see no compelling reason to ascribe conceptual realism to Hegel. And I worry that the independence of the conceptual world from our concepts that is claimed threatens the very normativity of judgment of concept use with a skeptical problems besetting realism and its more forceful independent claim. So if objects and their structural conceptual relations are completely independent of our concepts, then we basically have no guarantee that our concepts are going to latch onto them. That, I take it, is actually what Hegel from the very beginning, from the introduction onward, is trying to argue. So against realism in this sense, I take it that Hegel already at the end of the sense certainty chapter invokes animals who fail to respect the independence of their prey when they gobble them up. So Hegel suggests that these animals, like most contemporary philosophers of the time, need instruction in the mysteries of Ceres and Bacchus, the lower mysteries of bread and wine, which prepare the way, according to Hölderlin's poem of the same name, for the higher mysteries of the Eucharist. Both the lower and the higher mysteries are mysteries that would have us despair of the independent existence of things and see things in their thoroughgoing negativity as significant only in and through the difference relations through which we navigate as self-conscious living beings. I do not take Hegel to leave immediate sensible relations to real things standing at the end of sense certainty. The conclusion of Hegel's discussion of perception also seems to me to call into question the fundamental status of things with properties. Efforts to unpack properties in terms of necessary structural patterns of inclusion and exclusion are important, but I don't think that Hegel can accept them as anything but provisional, as is for Hegel all classification of kinds and laws in nature, as he argues in detail in Observing Reason. Hegel concludes the perception chapter with the idea that we directly perceive the thing itself as an unconditioned universal, as the thing in itself, or noumenon, insofar as we grasp it in terms of the unity that it has in relation to all of the actual and counterfactual relations in which it stands. This makes me skeptical of Brandom's attempt to treat force and understanding and the play of forces as an allegory for the introduction of theoretical entities. It seems to me that it is rather the other way around. Our grip on theoretical entities is a kind of reification of our grip on the forces or powers that directly manifest themselves to us in what things do and can do. And here Hegel is thinking of Leibnizian forces, not Newtonian ones. Hegel disliked Newton and Newtonian mechanics, and he uses the term solicitation to indicate that he's appealing to Leibniz. So I agree, the point being that for Leibniz and Kant, there are no things that are fundamental in the way that Newtonian atoms are. They're all plays of force. So I think this conception goes all the way down. The notion of a thing is just something of pragmatic significance, as are its properties and relations. So while I agree with Brandom that Hegel rejects the Quinean and Lewisian object-oriented and extensional conceptions of modality, I don't think that Hegel is committed to modal realism at all. Possible worlds are only as real for Hegel as are the powers that things display to us. The core of A Spirit of Trust is its account of structural compatibilities and incompatibilities between properties of objects of the kind that can be expressed in formal and especially material inferences. Brandom's sophisticated development of Seller's inferential role semantics and of Seller's realism is prominent and undeniably work of the first order. Brandom emphasizes, though, what he calls conceptual realism, and according to such hylomorphic conceptual realism, their flanking correspondence relations between deontic, normative, and alethic modal relations of compatibility and incompatibility on the subject and object side. Taking thoughts to stand in representative relations to facts implicitly involves commitment to the possibility of an isomorphism between subjective normative relations of incompatibility and consequence and objective modal relations of incompatibility and consequence. And the model does not semantically preclude such an isomorphism from holding objectively, at least locally and temporarily. And in a note to this passage, he says that it cannot in principle hold globally and permanently is a deep feature of Hegel's understanding of sensuous and matter-of-factual immediacy. So for Brandom, conceptual realism is not the final story. Conceptual realism gives way to what he calls objective idealism and then to conceptual idealism. I would argue, however, that he gives too much autonomy to conceptual realism and even to objective idealism as he understands it. But I agree with him that the final word in Hegel's account is the dynamic process of conceptual idealism, or rather the unity of conceptual realism, objective idealism, and conceptual idealism in absolute idealism. My final point is just that I'm not sure that that ultimate unity allows one to preserve conceptual realism except as a first approximation.
Thank you. If I understand him properly, Keller's engaged in an epic battle against philosophical views that are committed, whether they explicitly realize it or not, to an order of explanation that he calls semantic realism. He sees such views as pervasive and pandemic, and takes it that a principal virtue of Hegel and his tradition, beginning already with Kant, but continuing with such figures as Jaspers and Cassirer, is that they diagnose the pathologies of this sort of realism and develop and recommend healthier alternative modes of fundamental understanding. And from this vantage point, he then wants to know whether my Hegel is visible as enlisted in this Manichaean struggle at all, and if so, is he on the right side? Do I properly portray him as a good guy, or am I sufficiently unable to free myself from the predominantly realist presuppositions to do so? So he says, I side with Hegel's dynamic conceptual idealism against contemporary semantic realism and its claims to be or replacing first philosophy. Well, I want to make a number of distinctions here that it seems to me are getting run together under the heading of semantic realism. One is, when we're asking whether subjects and objects are independent of one another, a question of independence is always relative to the particular kind of dependence that one is talking about. Are objects independent of subjects? Well, in one sense, yes, and in another sense, no. I distinguish between reference dependence and sense dependence, using this Frege'ian distinction that I ultimately interpret in Hegelian terms. What I take to be a platitude, take to be a common sense realism, is the view that there was a world with laws of nature, remotely robust subjunctive relationships in it, things that were fragile before there were human beings, thinkers or talkers, and there would have been even if there never had been subjects. The existence of what's referred to by object vocabulary and what's referred to by subject vocabulary, there could be objects without subjects, there could not be subjects without objects. At the level of reference, the dependence is one way in the object to subject direction. I take the beginning of idealist wisdom to be saying, but that's not true at the level of senses. When you talk about an objective world, a world that has objects and properties in it that stand to one another in law-like relationships, if you want to understand what you're saying about the world when you say that, you have to do that in a context that includes people making claims, that's correlative with stating facts, people using singular terms and predicates, that's correlative, that's part of understanding what you mean by talking about objects with properties. You have to be talking in a context where people are making subjunctively robust inferences in explanation in order to understand what you mean by saying there's a law-like relation between these properties. That's what I call objective idealism, is that there's a reciprocal sense dependence between the vocabulary we use to specify the categorical structure of the objective world and the pragmatic meta-vocabulary that we use to describe our discursive practices, what we're doing in referring, classifying, asserting, and inferring. In order to understand what we're saying when we use terms like object and property, fact and law, you have to understand that, the relation between the senses, what you're expressing in that case. You have to understand those both together. I don't think you can understand referring and classifying, asserting and inferring without understanding the talk about objects and properties, facts and laws, either one. I think that's a reciprocal sense dependence. So I don't think you need to choose between the denial of reference dependence of the objective realm on the subjective realm, and the assertion of sense dependence between them. Now, it's controversial to wheel in Phrygian machinery of a distinction between sense and reference to make this Hegelian point, but I go to some trouble in the ninth chapter of the book to motivate Hegelian versions of these Phrygian notions. They're quite different in many ways, in important ways, from Frege's, but they have in common that they underwrite this sort of distinction. Now, while I'm in the vicinity, let me mention in passing that I think in the reading of Force and Understanding, when we're talking about whether Hegel is a modal realist, I agree that he doesn't care at all about possible worlds, doesn't think about possible worlds. Indeed, I take that to be the point of the inverted world discussion of modality, is to think not in terms of possible worlds. But I think, when I use the term modal realist and attribute that such a view to Hegel, I don't mean my teacher David Lewis's mad dog modal realism about possible worlds. I just mean that the objective world genuinely comes with laws of nature, with subjunctively robust objective relations that underwrite patterns of practices of explanation. So I don't think we're disagreeing in this point. And as far as the actual discussion of force is concerned, which for me is allegorical for a discussion of theoretical entities generally, that is, entities that are not observable, that we can only become entitled to claims about as the result of inference, I think the opposition between Newtonian and Leibnizian is a false opposition here. I take it that Hegel is specifically using Boscovich's version of Newtonian mechanics, which doesn't have particles or atoms in it at all. It's forces all the way down. Yes, that's a sort of Leibnizian version, but we know he read Boscovitz and he uses that particular vocabulary. In the deeper issues of conceptual realism, it seems to me we're on the same side here. That is, that the features of semantic realism that Pierre is most concerned to take issue with, so does my Hegel. And I take it that that's compatible with the maintenance of conceptual realism as one perspective. At the center of the conceptual idealism, the third aspect of absolute idealism that I take Hegel to be expounding, is precisely a concern with the Begriffsbewegung, the movement of concepts that is part of the contrast class between semantic realism. It's part of what semantic realism in Pierre's sense does not appreciate, thinking that this applies from the ground up, what he calls a dynamic, fundamentally historical and inclusive, but also systematically structural conception of reason. I think we're together in attributing this to Hegel. Indeed, it's precisely seeing that first sparked my interest in Hegel. In making it explicit, I didn't talk at all about the process of determining or acquiring conceptual content. I treated language as something that was always already up and running. It was there, and didn't talk about conceptual change at all, just looked at a time slice. Indeed, it was putting to one side the question of the development of concepts that made that book writable for me. But it was always with the implicit restriction, yeah, but I'm going to get around to it. And I'm going to have to worry about that development of concepts. And it was Hegel that I thought, no, this is where one should look for this. I was much taken in making explicit already with the distinction of social perspective between undertaking or acknowledging a commitment oneself and attributing it to someone else. And I could see what I came to think of as Hegel's picture of norms as instituted by reciprocal attitudes of recognition as built around this distinction of social perspective, an I-thou kind of sociality rather than an I-we sociality, the we built up out of these recognitive relations. But I didn't, in those early days, at all think about the temporal historical distinction between prospective and recollective retrospective perspectives on concept use. And that's what I think about above all is the key to the story that Hegel tells in the Phenomenology. And indeed, it's the emphasis on that distinction of social perspective between the prospective and the retrospective perspectives that makes me prefer the Phenomenology to the treatment in the Logic, where that gets pushed to the margins. I found in Hegel a fascinating new understanding of the sense in which ordinary concepts can be thought of as having concepts, having contents that are determinate. It starts with the process of determining them, determining those contents and instituting the norms governing the use of expressions by adopting practical attitudes of applying those concepts in some circumstances and not in others to make judgments and inferences. If you look forward prospectively, this is a process of determining their contents by making them more determinate. Every time we apply a concept or refuse to apply it in a concrete circumstance, we're adding a little bit of content to it, making the concepts more determinate. But looking backward, recollecting prior uses by rationally reconstructing an expressively progressive tradition, I think this notion of recollective rationality is the form of reason's march through history for Hegel. It's this idea of rationally reconstructing what we've done as a cumulative project of making explicit something that now shows up as having been implicit all along. And it's from that point of view that one can be a conceptual realist. Looking backwards, you say, oh, well, I see that these were the facts, these were the objects and the kind of properties there were, these were the laws, and here's how we gradually found that out. And we can understand genuine knowledge here.
In a lot of this, we're on the same page, but I still think that you have two different commitments. One to the idea that we can refer to things in a way that's completely independent of our social historical context. And another, according to which we're tied to that historical social context. And from the beginning of your reading of the introduction to the reading of the sense certainty throughout, you insist that there's a way in which we're directly able to refer, or at least are in contact with things. And my point is that that should, by the exigencies of the argument that you're reconstructing from Hegel, disappear. And so any significance to the idea of getting things right from a God's eye view should just drop out. I'm not saying that we give up on reference. I'm just saying that this super duper notion of the way the world is completely independent of knowers or concept users seems to me to be nonsensical, because how would one grasp that except from the counterfactual stance of concept users?
I mean, my claim is that these are two sides of one coin, that retrospectively, one sees reference, one sees the objects represented as having been there all along, just the way they were, though one is, and what one is reconstructing is just our practices as finding out about them. But that's only half the story. The other half of the story, the other recognitive perspective of these two historical perspectives, is precisely the prospective progressive one, in which the very notion of the object that we're referring to is the product of our practices, inferences, and so on. So, I mean, there's a question about whether you can hold these in equilibrium. My claim is this is a structure of reciprocal authority and responsibility that has exactly the structure of reciprocal recognition. It's that social structure, but in this particular historical version of it. But yeah, the challenge is to coherently hold those perspectives together. But I think that's Hegel's challenge, and I think he evidently brings it off.
So just one point. I agree completely with the idea of bringing different perspectives together. And so I'm on board with that. But it seems to me that one of these perspectives that you want to bring together with the others isn't a perspective at all. It's the way things are viewed from a point of view that's no point of view at all. And that's the God's eye view of concepts. And I just don't think that Hegel has a place for that.
I think that realist perspective, each time when we look back, it's sort of our job to see things that way, to see ourselves as having been responsive to a way things always were already anyway. But this is where the conceptual instability comes in. Every such view, and we know this going forward, is doomed to show itself inadequate. It's doomed to lead us to commitments that are incompatible by the lights of that view, by correctly applying the concepts according to that view, to show us no, things actually weren't that way. Now we need another recollective story about, you know, where we are now. So the self-consciousness that we're to achieve, the philosophical self-consciousness, is precisely to realize the instability and provisional nature of those retrospective realistic commitments at every point. But the notion of the objective world is structurally implicated in this whole process. That's not something we get over, though we get wiser about it.
So what does the commitment come to? If it's a commitment that at the same time I'm making it, I'm aware is just not really worth much in a certain important sense. I mean, it's unstable. It's provisional. It's going to be. I'm going to recognize soon enough that it doesn't make sense, or that I have to replace it with some other commitment. What does it mean for it to be a commitment? I'm having trouble seeing how somebody could hold those things together at the same time.
If and insofar as you see the provisional contingent character of all of your commitments, doesn't that undercut the rational bindingness of them? And this is a point at which I take Hegel's concern that our fallibilism not turn inquiry into a path of skeptical despair, making that fallibilist meta-induction that you're talking about. I take it this is a point where his thought makes deep contact with the later Wittgensteins, where Wittgenstein, as the prophet of the contingent character of the contents of all of our concepts, the way in which they're contingent on features of our embodiment and of our particular history, how can that not make the norms that we see the contingency of lose their grip on us, be less binding? I mean, rational bindingness is not a Wittgensteinian term. That's a Hegelian notion, but it is the same thing. How can that not undercut the commitment to it? And the claim is that properly understanding this historically biperspectival recollective structure gives us a form of recognition, an awareness of norms that lets us see that that very instability is the price of the determinate contentfulness. It's the only way we can have determinately contentful thoughts is by applying concepts that are fragile in this way, that are doomed to be found not to be fully adequate. That's just the nature of our grip on things. It exceeds any particular determinate conceptualization of it. Wittgenstein, as I see him, just says, get over it, get used to it, that's the way things are. Hegel has an elaborate systematic account of how to get over it, how to understand it so as not to be alienated from one's commitments by seeing this about them.
Dean Moyer is an associate professor of philosophy at Johns Hopkins University. He works on Kant, German idealism, political philosophy, and ethics, and he's the author of, among other things, a book entitled Hegel's Conscience, published by Oxford 2011.
Thank you. Thanks for putting this together. I hadn't realized till just now that how much material from mine repeats some issues that Pierre Keller was just talking about. So I'm going to do something kind of on the fly that I've just extracted an acceptance from Bob that this is okay. My piece is excerpted from a larger piece that is in a book that I promised Tony Bruce at Rutledge I would mention. It's just been published, Reading Brandom on a Spirit of Trust from Rutledge, edited by Gilles Bouche. And so this was excerpted from that. I'm going to, on the fly, kind of cut something out of that and read a bit more of something that ended up at the end of my comments today, just so I'm not repeating so much what Pierre said. One of Brandom's opening gambits in A Spirit of Trust is to distinguish between the apparently absurd idea of the reference dependence of objects on thinking, on the one hand, and the much more palatable idea of the sense dependence of objects on thinking, on the other. He denies that Hegel endorses reference dependence, for he takes Hegel to be a realist who holds that there is a world out there whether we think it or not. Yet Brandom argues and claims that Hegel argues that there are no reference that contrast with senses in the end, for reference turn out to be ideal senses. What then becomes of the original denial that Hegel's idealism includes a claim of reference dependence? More generally, how does Brandom keep a realist dimension while doing justice to the radicality of Hegel's idealism? So to begin with two of the main building blocks of Brandom's reading of Hegel, conceptual realism and objective idealism. Conceptual realism is the platitudinous view that the world, or the non-mental world, really is structured by modally robust relations of exclusion and inclusion. Now, I'm not at all sure that this view is self-evident or non-controversial. We just got an account from Pierre on why that's the case. Not self-evident or non-controversial, but I cannot adjudicate that issue here. This is a conceptual realism because, as Bob tells us, on Hegel's non-psychological view, concepts are, quote, relations of material incompatibility and so consequence. And the claim that Brandom extracts from the first three chapters of the Phenomenology and the transition to self-consciousness is what he calls objective idealism. This is the view that there is, quote, a symmetrical sense dependence of the concepts articulating subjective processes of concept use and concepts articulating objective conceptual relations. Now, Brandom admits that this idealism might not seem idealistic enough or crazy enough to be Hegel's view. Objective idealism describes more of a truce between the objective and subjective than the priority of the subjective suggested by some of Hegel's bolder pronouncements about the essential subjectivity of substance. This leads him then into the next phase, the conceptual idealism. And I want to sort of press on how this kind of then relates back to the issue of reference and sense. So tying the sense reference claim back to his main argument for conceptual idealism, Brandom argues that the expressive truth process, a continuous process of improvement recounted after the fact, quote, secures the semantic and cognitive relations between senses and their reference. This is the conceptual idealism track that he was just kind of going over in his response to Pierre. The conceptual idealism and conceptual realism turn out to be mutually supporting. For, quote, a realist commitment is implicit in practically acknowledging the representational dimension of concept use. As Hegel often tells us, following Kant, his idealism is his way, and he claims the only ultimately satisfactory way of making realism intelligible. Just as our initially abstract intentions become intelligible in becoming actual, the real world of facts become intelligible through our theoretical and practical engagement with the world. So my first concern is just with a potential kind of bait and switch move in Brandom's realism and the sense reference distinction. With his initial appeal to conceptual realism as a claim about the mind independence of the world's relations of incompatibility, and his treatment of objective idealism as fully compatible with that realism, Brandom invites the reader to think of Hegel's view as a sober interpretive superstructure on an already constituted realm of objective relations. Brandom first introduces the sense reference distinction into his interpretation of Hegel in laying out the nature of the objective idealism claim. The objective relations and subjective processes are said to be reciprocally sense dependent. Opposed to this is the genuinely crazy claim of reference dependence, which he glosses as a claim about existence. But, and here comes the switch, the sense reference distinction seems to break down in his discussion in chapter 12, and Brandom seems to aim to break it down with a deflationary understanding of reference. So he claims then that reference are expressively ideal senses, and reference are a privileged kind of sense, are claims about reference as normative standards revealed in processes of sense making. The problem is that it is not clear where that leaves his initial claims about realism or the initial claims about the reference dependence that contrast with sense dependence. When he moves to the claim that senses produce the reference, I really start to lose my grip on how the distinction could underwrite the conceptual realism and the objective idealism. It seems that the reciprocal sense dependence claim, suitably amped up, becomes a reciprocal reference dependence claim. His conceptual realism seems to disallow this, but it is hard to tell how it would be avoided in the end. Is there enough left of the sense reference distinction to preserve the realist point? My second question is closely related to the first and concerns the way in which senses and reference are supposed to relate to each other. Brandom holds that the role played by truth in Frege's version of the sense reference relation is played in Hegel by concern for correct inferences for what a sense or content really follows from and is really incompatible with what. There must be a way that things are independent of our attitudes, but we cannot access this directly. We must, rather, approach how things really are through making inferences about how things show up for us, present themselves to us. And Brandom clearly wants to have it both ways here, to adhere to a realism about how things really are, but to determine how things really are only through how they appear, so that the best current story about appearance really is how things are. And this seems unstable to me as a truce between realism and idealism. The realist will always feel like the account is one step short of saying what the really real amounts to, and the idealists will feel like the account only aims at discovery of what is already there. To the realist, Brandom's Hegel will seem like a radical social constructivist, while to the idealist, the view will seem to be too tame to count as absolute idealism. So I ended my prepared comments that I sent to everyone with one line about a relation of Brandom's view to Rorty's. I skipped a page of this so I could say a little bit more about that so that I'm not just kind of repeating stuff that Pierre pressed him on. And in particular, just to kind of invite Bob to say a little bit more about how he sees the relation of his settled view that he arrives at here with Rorty's view. And if, you know, if we look back to the piece that Bob wrote for the, I think, Reading Rorty volume of 2000, Brandom there is criticizing Rorty's Davidsonian claim that the world consists of things and their causal relations, and they can only cause and not justify a claim or belief. So recall, you know, Rorty's position following Davidson is that justification is inferential, and what justifies a claim or belief is only another claim or belief. Every truth and fact for Rorty depends on a human vocabulary, so that without vocabularies, there are no truths and no fact. And in that piece, Brandom chastises Rorty for doing away with the facts that can make claims correct or incorrect. That is, he criticizes Rorty for doing away with the realistic core that Brandom attributes to Hegel. Rorty could be said to rely for justification solely on the subjective processes that figure in the reciprocal sense-dependent claim of objective idealism and conceptual idealism. And I guess the question then is, how can Brandom really hold on to his realistic core and not sort of flip over into the Rortian position where the conceptual idealism basically swallows the realistic core? Do I have another minute?
Just 1 minute.
Okay. So just to mention there that what Rorty had argued for is a kind of pragmatism of complementary vocabularies. And sometimes I get the sense that's also Bob's view. Sometimes he really seems to want to push back against this Rortian view. And I'll just sort of mention in closing, Rorty's own response to Brandom was to claim that the move to the social is not enough to get a robust account of facts off the ground. And the claim, as Rorty makes it, that such a robust account of facts is not really even in the end desirable. It gives too much away to the sort of hardcore scientistic view of the world and doesn't sort of leave enough autonomy for the practical world of democracy and so on. I'll leave it there.
Pierre and Dean are getting at absolutely the core of the enterprise here. How do these perspectives get together? Just as slogans, for the realism, you can think about Wittgenstein saying, when we say and mean that things are thus and so, we and our meaning don't stop anywhere short of the fact. We mean this is so. That's a realistic perspective. I'm saying it's the task of recollective rationality to rationally reconstruct the process that eventuated in our current commitments in a way that vindicates that. That says, okay, if that's how things are, here's how we could have found that out and found out exactly that things are thus and so. On the other hand, Hegel says, appearance is the arising and passing away that does not itself arise and pass away, but is in itself and constitutes the actuality and the movement of the life of truth. And this is from paragraph 47 of the preface. He says this in the same paragraph in which he gives his famous definition of truth as a vast bacchanalian revel with not a soul sober. And usually people focus on that instead of this other. I mean, I think they're both wonderful. But the question is, that's the way things look prospectively, that every commitment we've got becomes revealed eventually as mere appearance of something else. That experience of having what we took to be the way things were in themselves revealed as only being the way they were for consciousness, that doesn't arise and pass away the way the individual appearances do. And yet, there's a rational obligation to reconstruct the new commitments that we come to as a result of the unmasking of the old ones in this realistic way. Well, now we are really saying of what is that it is. How can we get these perspectives together? How does Hegel propose to get these perspectives together to entitle us to say both of them, to get an overarching meta perspective from which these show up as einseitig, to be true, to be sure, one-sided, because tied to a perspective, but parts of an overarching view. Dean, you say bait and switch, I say richly nuanced view. the sort of question is, does he give us the conceptual machinery to reconcile? And let me just say two things about that. I'm claiming that eventually these show up as standing to each other in relations of authority and responsibility that have the structure of reciprocal recognition. So let me quickly say, look, I'm entirely authoritative about who I recognize, who I take to be another normative subject able to commit themselves, or to be a good chess player. That's entirely up to me. That's my authority. But then I make myself responsible to those that I recognize. I grant them the authority to either recognize me in turn or not. And whether I am a normative subject or a good chess player is now dependent on whether I'm recognized as such by the ones I recognize as such. I have the authority to recognize them, but then I make myself responsible to them. This reciprocal recognitive structure of authority and responsibility also obtains between the prospective and retrospective perspectives historically. In the book, more times than I probably should, I use the example of case law, judge-made law, and the relation between the authority of the current judge over past judges to recognize their decisions as precedential, but then answering to future judges for the question of whether one has been responsible to the norm that they instituted. So that's just gesturing in the direction of how there could so much as be a reconciliation of this. The second thing to say specifically about the sense and reference, one of the lessons that Hegel, that I take Hegel to take him to have learned from Kant, is that the notion of representation, one of Kant's core notions, is fundamentally a normative notion. That to talk about something as represented by something that counts as a representing in virtue of representing that thing is to talk about the represented as having a certain kind of authority over assessments of the correctness of the representing. To be a representing is to be liable to assessments of correctness according to a standard that's set by what you count as what counts as represented by your representing, just in virtue of playing that normative role of a standard. So I see Hegel as taking his recognitive notion of how normative statuses are instituted by reciprocal recognition and applying it to this normative understanding of representation, and doing that by looking at the specifically historical version of reciprocal recognition. Now, that's a lot of pieces that have to work together.
My question, just in the same vein, is about sense reference and or sense dependence and reference dependence, because I don't really understand how they can be held apart. The way I learned the sense reference distinction is that sense is the condition that determines reference. So if senses vary enough, or alter enough, or change enough, references will too. How are you understanding? So how are you understanding it, such that even the extension might not change if the mode of presentation or the way in which it's referred to does?
It's certainly clear that you can have multiple senses that pick out the same reference, but the way I'm talking about, that's where we came in with the morning star and the evening star, but for reference dependence and sense dependence coming apart, if you think about response-dependent properties, so suppose for something to be beautiful just as for it to be disposed to produce pleasure in people, then we can say that the notion of beauty is sense-dependent on the notion of pleasure, at least that notion is. You can't understand what having that response-dependent property of being beautiful is unless you understand what pleasure is, but they're not reference dependent. There could be, on that account, there could have been beautiful sunsets before there were any people who could display pleasure. It's just if there had been people there, they would have responded with pleasure. It's a dispositional issue. So response dependent properties are sense dependent on the conception of the response, but they're not reference dependent on them. That's just a sort of non-controversial application of the notion.
I was wondering if the distinction and contrast between the principle of thoroughgoing determination and the principle of the determinability of appearances could be brought to bear on this question of asymmetrical reference dependence. Because it seems like If we have asymmetrical reference dependence, then we might think, well, things must be fully determinate and so subject to the principle of thoroughgoing determination. Whereas it seems that on the picture that you're giving us, there's another aspect of it that wants us to say, no, things are subject to a principle of determinability, and the bimodal hylomorphic conceptual realism involves an ongoing process of determination on both sides of the equation.
Well, though I don't make this point, it would have been a wonderful thing to have invoked this bit of Kant as an antecedent of Hegel's notion of the process of determining that gives us two perspectives on what's determinate, one in which we're finding out, we're determining a content is finding out how it always already was, and the other where determining it is making it more determinate. And what we're talking about is trying to see those not as Kant did, but as sort of reconcilable, as essentially two perspectives that together make up the phenomenon.
John Russon is a presidential distinguished professor at the University of Guelph. He has broad philosophical interests ranging from ancient philosophy to contemporary continental philosophy. He's published numerous books, including, for instance, Reading Hegel's Phenomenology, published by Indiana University Press in 2004.
Thanks. So in our everyday affairs, we commonly and easily say things like, look at that thing over there, or, okay, I understand, or you really should do that, and so on. These expressions are mostly non-reflective, practical responses to our situations, and we have little sense that we are employing concepts when we speak. But Hegel, on the contrary, in the Phenomenology, investigates quite rigorously just what we are doing when we employ terms like thing, understand, you, should, and so on. And his studies document exactly how these concepts are responsive to the terms in which our experience actually unfolds, and in so doing, he shows that though these concepts are capable of coherent coordination, we typically put on display various forms of dishonesty in our use of them. A cognitive dishonesty at the level of conceptual consistency, which is played out practically, and a cognitive dishonesty that often underpins a moral dishonesty in our intersubjective comportment. In A Spirit of Trust, Brandom does an outstanding job of laying out the precise conceptual parameters of many of Hegel's major demonstrations of exactly these sorts of things. Now, Hegel is, of course, notoriously compact in his presentation, requiring the reader to do the math, so to speak, by which I mean to figure out what it was that he tried to do as he ripped from here to there quickly. And it's worth remembering that in his book, he covers in roughly 500 pages the entire range of human experience, from the temporal flow of sensuous immediacy through the power dynamics of personal and interpersonal life to the history of 5,000 years of human political and religious life. So Brandom's study takes the time much more carefully to, as I say, do the math, working painstakingly through the logical and experiential intricacies that are implicit in many of Hegel's most important analyses. And Brandom demonstrates in doing that, in many cases, that Hegel has indeed captured the dynamism that is distinctive and definitive of human agency. There are many outstanding things in this book, in my judgment. But I think that Brandom's text is especially excellent for thematizing the role and the importance of what Hegel calls recognition. And it's worth remembering again that Hegel explicitly discusses recognition in only 19 paragraphs of the book. And that's the section called The Independence and Dependence of Self-Consciousness, which is the part A of chapter 4, Self-Consciousness. But those 19 paragraphs are the central subject of 220 pages of Brandom's Spirit of Trust, the whole of part 2 called Normative Pragmatics. And I believe it's the essential context for the whole of his study. So Brandom offers what one might call a naturalistic reconstruction of Hegel's argument, documenting what is at play when an agent imputes agency to another. And that means when a particular kind of organism, a particular kind of natural body, engages in a material practice that involves meaningfully responding to another body as itself a being that imputes agency to others. In his argument, Brandon very carefully builds up, sort of inch by inch, the constitutive, logical, pragmatic layers of this experience, ultimately to vindicate Hegel's claim that such interpersonal recognition is always implicitly defined by a demand for reciprocity, with the consequence that our behavior contradicts its own norm when we practice unequal recognition. I would like to talk in more detail about that, but I'm not going to. I'm going to quickly try to move now to something that I'm a little bit critical of that's related to that. So it is these practices of reciprocal recognition that I think are the foundation of pretty much everything that Brandom goes on to say. It's these practices of reciprocal recognition that are what Hegel, that Brandom maintains are what Hegel means by freedom. So freedom, Brandom writes, is Hegel's term for the symmetrical recognitive constellation that integrates immediacy as the actuality of attitudes with their social mediation through the requirement of suitable complementation of attitudes for their institutional authority. Where again, he writes, this constitutive constellation of reciprocal authority and responsibility, normative independence and dependence, Hegel calls freedom. Now, in emphasizing that word freedom, Brandom is responding to a shift in Hegel's own language from part A to part B of the self-consciousness chapter, the shift from the independence and dependence of self-consciousness to the freedom of self-consciousness. And he is assimilating that shift in terminology to the fact that, as he has, I believe, correctly shown, part A demonstrates that self-consciousness is only properly realized in situations of reciprocal recognition. It's here, however, that I have a challenge to Brandom's interpretation of Hegel, and which is, in a sense, a textual matter, but I think there's a deeper matter. Correspondingly, I have a challenge to an aspect of his analysis of our experience. For in my view, Hegel's point in his phenomenological study of what he calls freedom is that there is a further dimension to our experience beyond that identified in his analysis of recognition, and hence irreducible to it. And let me add one more thing. This book, as you might expect by the size of it and the author, is characterized throughout by subtlety and precision. So now I'm going to say something about two paragraphs that's very big and substantial. It's not going to be subtle and precise. So there is it's kind of ham-fisted, really. But I really want to emphasize that the book is the opposite. The book is profoundly careful. So I may turn out just to have missed the point. In any case, Brandom's interpretation of this section, the section Hegel calls freedom, which is where Hegel talks about stoicism, skepticism, and unhappy consciousness, Brandom's interpretation echoes Kojève's interpretation of these as what Kojève calls slave ideologies. Brandom writes, these are the forms of the ideology of mastery that become available to the subordinates in traditionally recognitive asymmetrical constellations of power and normativity. In other words, stoicism and skepticism and unhappy consciousness I think are really understood as unequal situations, ways that people kind of, almost like defense mechanisms, ways that people kind of deal with that structure without really addressing it. I don't think that the analysis in Kojève is correct, and relatedly, I don't think the analysis in Brandom is correct about that, because I think it fails to grasp both the structure of Hegel's argument, but also the experiential weight of the phenomena that Hegel is trying to study in his discussion of stoicism, skepticism, and unhappy consciousness. So scholarly matters of textual interpretation aside, this issue is important because it is a matter first of the accurate description of the form experience actually takes, and hence of the explanandum, and consequently, it's crucial to determine what will count as satisfactory explanands. Basically, these forms of experience make apparent an experience of meaning that, I believe, is neither reducible to nor explicable in terms of recognition. So the recognition of one agent by another is always a matter of practice. An individual either does or doesn't do it, or more exactly, a practice does or doesn't measure up to the recognition of the other that is already implicit in that practice, in one's practice. So, but if mutual recognition is thus always a particular and contingent practice, then the universal that is established there, the we, is always a conditioned or relative universal. While every particular practice of reciprocal recognition may intend universality in that it implies all such subjects should be recognized, the communities of mutual recognition that are actually enacted will always fall far short of including all agents. Now, if such accomplished universality, such reciprocal recognition, were the condition of freedom, then freedom would be a mere ought, as Hegel likes to say, rather than something actual. In fact, however, I think Hegel's point in this section is that freedom is a phenomenon. It is actual. And what he calls stoicism, skepticism, and unhappy consciousness are its different forms of realization, even in a world, maybe even particularly in a world, in which universal reciprocal recognition does not exist. H.S. Harris, I think, captures the fundamental meaning of freedom in Hegel when he writes that Hegel is addressing how there can be, as there evidently is, an eternal standpoint within time. We know, Harris writes, we know intuitively that this absolute standpoint exists. So it's this issue of an absolute standpoint. We do indeed have the experience of recognizing other agents. And it is the practical and the epistemic conditions implied by the fact of this experience of recognizing other agents that Hegel and Brandom articulate in the study of the independence and dependence of self-consciousness. But we also have the experience of recognizing truths, the meaning of which by definition exceeds any possible experience. This is what Harris means when he refers to the eternal standpoint. And this, it seems to me, is what Hegel studies in Part B of the Freedom of Self-Consciousness. When we make moral or mathematical claims, for example, it's integral to the meaning of these claims that they apply infinitely, which is to say beyond the limits of our own finite experience. And this is part of what it means to say that we experience these claims as necessary. And as Kant and Descartes showed with respect to mathematical and moral claims, the condition for our experiencing of the necessity of these claims is precisely our freedom. And that's where I think Hegel's term is coming from. So what is crucial here is that we do have this experience of necessity, and that means our freedom is attested to us whether or not others acknowledge it. That is why the Stoicism of Epictetus, for example, can be a phenomenon of freedom. Even though Epictetus himself was a slave, which is to say his equality in principle with all others was not recognized in practice, he nonetheless has his own status as precisely irreducible to how others take him, available and attested for himself. Skepticism and what Hegel calls unhappy consciousness are, as I understand them, further developments within this non-recognitive, non-interpersonal domain of autonomy. Skepticism recognizes the fundamental fact that reality appears to us, and thus it is insufficient on its own terms to account for the fact of experience as such, inasmuch as it is a phenomenon of it. And I take it this is the same point as the one as saying appearance is the arising and passing away that does not itself arise and pass away. Unhappy consciousness is the experience within the parameters of the skeptical recognition of the irreducible autonomy of experience as such. It is the recognition of compelling imperatives, imperatives that come not from external reality, but from within the experience of subjectivity itself. Mathematical experience is the recognition of the imperative intrinsic to free subjectivity itself to, for example, hold equals to be equal. This mathematical imperative, like the categorical imperative morality, is however not deducible from anything empirical. It is, on the contrary, a norm to which the empirical is held, nor is it truly realizable empirically, inasmuch as there are ultimately no unambiguous empirical examples of equality. From all sides, in other words, the mathematical ideal or imperative of equality is an absolute and unequivocal meaning, which is Harris's eternal standpoint, that informs an always equivocal, inherently relative experience. It is thus a form of experience that is in principle is irreducible to, and hence inexplicable by, the terms of empirical or natural life. This, I believe, is the meaning of freedom in Hegel's phenomenology. It's precisely the fact, definitive of our experience or of our reality, that the form our experience takes can never be adequately explained from the ground up, so to speak, in terms of our empirical engagement with nature or even with other self-conscious. So that's the main point I want to make, that it seems to be Hegel is documenting a dimension of meaning that happens in experience that is not reducible to, among other things, recognition. And then a last quick thing about the book more broadly. This challenge I'm making to Branham's interpretation of freedom in terms of recognition also leads me to challenge one other claim from A Spirit of Trust. Branham's interpretation centrally revolves around a distinction he imputes to Hegel between modern and traditional interpretations of normativity, which he began by mentioning. And I believe he's right to assert that there is such a distinction, and he's right to assert that Hegel's argument pivots around it. But I understand the distinction a little bit differently than he does. Branham relies on the notion of recognition to explain this, and he interprets ancient and traditional culture as recognizing commanding authority, recognizing the commanding authority of norms without acknowledging the weight of the subordinate perspective that attributes authority to those norms. And he interprets modern culture as recognizing the authoritative power of essentially individualistic practice of positing norms without sufficiently acknowledging the sense in which that individuality is itself dependent upon the recognition of norms. Now, I think that point is, in fact, fine as far as it goes, but I believe Hegel's analysis actually goes a little bit farther and depends as much or more on the notion of unhappy consciousness that I've been introducing here as explanation. And I think that Hegel's point is that modern culture has recognized not that individuals make norms, and that term make is a one that Branham uses, but that individuals are the kind of being for whom absolute norms are meaningful and compelling. The failing of ancient culture, I believe, is that it does not recognize the irreducible autonomy of unhappy consciousness, whereas the failing of modern culture, I believe, is that it does not recognize the essentiality of recognition. So anyway, broadly, I mean, the book is great, but I think this is one issue in Hegel's analysis of self-consciousness that I think goes in a somewhat different direction than I think Branham is taking it. Thanks.
Let me just say something about freedom and recognition. One place to start is Kant's view in the second critique that we should understand freedom in terms of responsibility. That wherever there's genuine responsibility, a normative status, there's freedom that goes with that. This is by contrast to empiricist ways of thinking that think they already understand freedom in terms of determinism and are going to read off whether we can be count as responsible for anything, exploiting something like the same connection. But Kant is also vastly impressed by Rousseau's claim that subjection to a law one has laid down for oneself is freedom. And so Kant combines these with the idea that freedom is the capacity to undertake normative statuses, to be bound by norms, to be responsible, but it's only intelligible if that's the capacity to bind yourself by norms. That's the way freedom can consist in constraint by norms as long as it's a form of self-binding. And as I read him, Hegel comes along and says, yes, that's true, but it's not something you can do all by yourself. The normative status requires not just that you acknowledge a responsibility, but that someone holds you responsible for it. Those are the two recognitive attitudes. I acknowledge, but in acknowledging, exercising my authority to acknowledge a commitment, I am authorizing you to hold me responsible. I'm making myself responsible to you. And only in that way can there be some determinate content to the content, is the thought. Whatever seems right to me is right, then there's no talk of right or wrong, here Wittgenstein says. So that's why the institution of the paradigmatic normative status of being committed or responsible has to involve this reciprocal recognitive relation, authority on one side, responsibility on the other, but reciprocal authority and responsibility. The trouble with the subordination obedience structure of normativity, that asymmetric structure, good that it's social, it has two sides, but what the master, allegorical for pure independence, independence, authority, dependence, responsibility in this normative structure, is that he doesn't appreciate that his authority depends on its acknowledgement by the subordinate, that he is the master insofar as he is taken to be the master by the subordinate. The master, construing himself as purely independent, as autonomous, doesn't acknowledge the authority of the one he's making responsible to him, the subordinate. This is the sort of deep connection between authority, responsibility, recognition, and freedom, as I see it. And it's very important for Hegel that for that responsibility or commitment, whether it's empirical or practical, to be determinately contentful, the one who is undertaking the commitment cannot be sort of solely authoritative about what they've made themselves responsible to, what they've committed themselves to. And he understands that determinateness as incorporating contingent, immediate actuality in the form of the attitudes that people actually adopt into the content of our commitments. That's how they become determinate. But that means that what your normative statuses are in the first instance depend on what community you have instituted, who you've recognized, who's recognized you, what they hold you responsible for. It isn't absolute. It isn't eternal. Recognitive communities are essentially local and concrete. So does that mean that our freedom is entirely contingent on the actual attitudes that our fellows adopt to us, or is there a higher point of view, a more absolute point of view? And here, I think, Hegel thinks absolute knowing, as alarming phrase from the end of the book, the form of self-consciousness that we're to arrive at by the end of the book, is to see that in engaging in discursive practice at all, in undertaking commitments, doxastic and practical, making judgments, performing intentional actions, we're implicitly acknowledging commitments that run beyond our particular recognitive community. We're implicitly acknowledging the authority of all the other discursive practitioners, even the ones that we're not standing in concrete recognitive relations with. And the ultimate imperatives that we share, the ultimate commitments that we've got, Kant would call them moral commitments. Hegel doesn't like that term for these, but these are Geist-constitutive commitments, are the ones that get unmasked as implicit in engaging in discursive practice within a concrete community at all. And by the end of the book, we're supposed to acknowledge these. I unpack this at the end of my book in terms of the form of reciprocal recognition that happens when we institutionalize the explicit acknowledgement of those implicit commitments, when recognition takes the final form of confession and forgiveness, which confession and forgiveness are the final forms of recognition and the form of normativity they institute, I call trust, following a single passage. Hegel doesn't emphasize this. But it's by unpacking these commitments that are implicit in being discursive practitioners at all that one can see philosophical vocabulary as the form of semantic self-consciousness and can see how semantics can have an edifying significance, can make a difference to our actual practical recognitive relations to each other as we institutionalize and so actualize the explicit acknowledgement of these implicit commitments.
I would just try to clarify a little bit where I'm imagine myself to be saying something a little bit different. So picking up on these things you said at the beginning, the remark from Rousseau about the capacity to bind ourselves by norms and so on. And coupling that with your remark that that's not something you can do by yourself, you must be held responsible by a community and so on. I think that's exactly right. So I guess in the context of norms and commitments and so on, I see Hegel as identifying what we might call a kind of horizontal dimension and a kind of vertical dimension. So the I can't do myself by myself insofar as I need this involvement with others. That's what I would think of as essentially the horizontal dimension of recognition. But that I is already non-uniform. And this is what I think the point of unhappy consciousness and skepticism and so on is, that I find myself already in a way split internally, such that I am a kind of recipient of meanings that are not coming to me externally. They're not empirical in that sense. So in that sense, we would say they're coming from myself, but they're not things that are under my control. And that's where I invoke things like a mathematical imperative to hold things equal or something like that. It seems to me that Hegel's analysis of freedom is working around that, the way that the I finds itself internally split, such that it is always in a position of answerability to norms, while at the same time being, so to speak, externally split, in that the I is always involved with others, and from neither side is the I or the ego simply a matter of self-defining self-possession. The realization of who we are and the realization of the meaning of those norms is always going to have to be carried out interpersonally and intersubjectively in communities of recognition and so on. I think what you say is right on. But I think that Hegel is identifying within any experiencing human self-conscious subject a basic experience of receptivity to meaning that is not reducible to those relations of recognition, even though it can only be realized in those relations of recognition. So that's just an attempt to focus more on where I'm coming at.
I think you're right that I don't make anything of the internal split of the I that you're seeing. And let me just acknowledge that though I have stories about skepticism, stoicism, and the unhappy consciousness, that section of the book doesn't do any serious work in advancing the argument that I'm seeing the book is making. My discussion of that is sort of pro forma. So here's how you can read it, given what I learned from the first part of chapter 4. And you're suggesting that there's real work being done there, even within the context of the sort of enterprise I see him as engaged in, that I'm just not making anything of. And you could well be right.
Okay.
Sebastian Stein is a research associate in philosophy at Heidelberg University. His interests include ethics, political philosophy, metaphysics, Kant, and post-Kantian idealism. He's recently co-edited a collection, Hegel's Political Philosophy on the Normative Significance of Method and System, published by Oxford University Press, 2017.
Right. Thank you very much. Thank you very much for the invitation, especially to Professor Helmut Wortscheider, and I feel greatly honored to be part of such a wonderful event. To me, Professor Brandom's latest book impressively proves that an unapologetically independent-minded engagement with Hegel's often mysterious prose can bear the sweet fruit of living truth. Instead of arguing over labels and the question whether Hegel's own understanding of his deduction of the categorical forms of self-consciousness maps seamlessly onto the project of pragmatist semantics, I would like to focus on a complication in Hegel's early work that might have undue impact on Professor Brandom's reading. This is the question of the relationship between self-consciousness and spirit, from here on Geist, or between appearance and truth. Hegel remains somewhat ambiguous on this relationship, with unfortunate consequences for the phenomenology as a whole and its relationship to the rest of his later system. Professor Brandom's reading seems to take a stance in favor of consciousness and against Geist in a manner that could place him at odds with Hegel's project and potentially his own. Throughout his book, Professor Brandom grounds his narrative on the theoretical and practical undertakings of particular self-conscious subjects. They use language, mutually ascribe norms, intentions, recognize each other, take epistemic stances, make inferences, historically recollect, and etc. Self-consciousness, understanding, reason, etc. is something they have. There might be facts without them, but no sense to these facts. Also, the meta-concepts of self-consciousness are categorical forms that apply to self-conscious, particular agents, and their thought and action. To Professor Brandom, Geist thus remains conceptually dependent on self-consciousness in the sense that Geist is the historical and social context of prioritized self-consciousness. Professor Brandom seems committed to this stance throughout the book and states, quote, "Nor does the objective world owe anything to the thinking activity of any super subject called Geist. This approach has manifold textual and conceptual grounds. After all, Hegel's work is called the Phenomenology of Geist, not Geist as it is in and for itself, or the Philosophy of Geist. And as Hegel admits, the phenomenology's analysis of Geist is presented from the perspective of consciousness. Hegel does not describe how Geist is for Geist as such, but how Geist is for us, particular self-conscious subjects. And yet, this still means that the phenomenology's analysis of consciousness and the development of its forms is truly an analysis of Geist. It is Geist that appears as consciousness, self-consciousness, reason, etc. Each category is more concrete than the previous one until Geist comes to itself, witnessed by a self-conscious thinker who himself is an aspect of the Geist he describes. To Hegel, Geist is thus not a name for the historical and social context of particular Kantian self-consciousness, as Professor Brandom claims. Instead, Geist is the ontological truth of self-consciousness. It is a self-transparent, manifest ground, the active condition of its possibility. Geist is self-consciousness in the sense that self-consciousness is the appearance of Geist, while Geist is Geist as it truly is. So at least in one sense, Hegel leaves Kant's and Fichte's fundamental commitment to consciousness behind and conceptually prioritizes Geist over consciousness. If we really want to comprehend what consciousness is and why it changes its categorical forms, we need to know Geist as the standard it is striving for. And since Geist grounds the whole project, we need Geist to explain why mutual self-conscious recognition can work, why trust can ever be warranted, why recognitive and ascriptive behavior can be successful, and why education and self-reconciliation through art, religion, and philosophy succeeds. Geist is thus the initially hidden unity between the particular self-conscious subjects that renders them and the world and them with each other compatible. This also makes Geist the fundamental, or as Hegel calls it, absolute subject. Professor Brandom's finite self-conscious subjects are its internal, particular manifestations. For them, Geist is their hidden ground. This also entails that mutual recognition by particular subjects is not the foundation of a successful ethical community, nor is individual and collective epistemic de- and ascriptive behavior ultimately responsible for successful knowledge acquisition. These are phenomena or the appearance of Geist. Why does this matter for Hegel's project and Professor Brandom's reading of it? Hegel gives ontological reasons for his preference of Geist over consciousness. If one were to posit particular consciousness and the alienation it effects between world and agent and between agents as fundamental in the manner Kant and Fichte did, and Professor Brandom seems to argue that Hegel does, all cognition, recognition, and other spiritual activity, such as reconciliation through art, religion, and philosophy, is only possible. With self-conscious subjects as basis, there's no conceptual resource to explain why cognition, recognition, education, and reconciliation are actual. If everyone and everything is primarily different, the identity invoked by the subsequent claim that sometimes things and subjects are compatible and cognition and recognition worked is tacked on. Cognition and recognition can happen, but they do not. Consciousness, finitude, and its difference between agents and between agents and world sabotages the notion of their congruence and reality. Because the particularity of self-consciousness undermines the notion of the necessity of what it grounds, it motivates Hegel's criticism of Kant's contractualist and Fichte's recognition-based approaches to political normativity. The notions of a contract entered into by particular parties and of norms based on recognition imply that adhering to the contract or engaging in recognition might as well not take place. The prioritized particular parties can freely decide not to do so. Relying on contract and recognition, much like relying on history, thus entails the contingency of whatever is supposed to be grounded rather than its simultaneous necessity. To avoid this, Hegel relies on the free causality of Geist. It grounds the actuality of successful recognition and the epistemic compatibility of self-consciousness and world. Geist is the singular common denominator whose identity ensures the necessity of its determinations, while its particularity ensures the freedom of its elements. It is what is always already there, is shared by all self-conscious particular subjects, and is objectified in the world. Subjects can cognize and recognize each other because they are Geist. Knowledge is achievable because Geist unites world and subject. Recognition takes place because there are institutions and norms of objective Geist, not vice versa. At the same time, the independence grounding difference between subject and world and between recognizing subject, and thus the possibility of the failure of cognition recognition, is also part of Geist's free causality. The subject and the world are compatible because both are Geist, and particular subjects do recognize each other as equals because they are Geist. As in necessity, the differentiated elements share an identity. At the same time, as in the case of contingency, each element retains its particularity. The cognizing subject is irreducibly subjective, the world truly objective. The recognizing subjects are different from each other. Geist's unity might remind some of Spinozism and trigger the worry that it undermines the particular subject's freedom and relative independence. However, as Hegel insists in the introduction to the Phenomenology and in his later works, Geist's freedom is not defined by substance's necessity, but by the concept's free causality and its moments of universality, particularity, and individuality. Instead of prioritizing universality's identity over particularity's difference at the expense of the latter, in the way Hegel thinks Spinoza's necessary substance does, Hegel's Geist speculatively unites universality and particularity. They are simultaneous in Geist's individuality. Geist is universal and particular at once. It is one in being many, independence, and many, independence, in being one. The manifold of Geist's particular and self-conscious subjects is thus explicable with reference to Geist's single universality. They are Geist. At the same time, the particular subjects are free and self-determining due to their irreducible particularity. Geist is them. Geist thus preserves rather than undermines the consciousness-based difference between agent and world and between agents. Unlike in Spinoza's substance or in the introduction's Night of Black Chaos, the particular individuals and their independence are preserved in Geist's singularity. Expanding Geist with reference to self-conscious subjects in Professor Brandom's manner might thus seem reductionist. While Geist explains the universal with reference to particulars and at the same time explains the particular with reference to the universal, Professor Brandom might only allow for the former. Still, Professor Brandom's profound conceptual insights are never wrong by Hegel's standards. Many also made it into Hegel's mature system, and they are brought to life in an unmistakably truth-loving manner by Professor Brandom's inspiring work.
Well, I think it's very helpful to ask about this distinction between individual recognizing and recognized consciousnesses on the one hand and Geist on the other. And there is a certain justice to the claim that I privilege the point of view of individual consciousness in telling the story that arrives at even-handed reciprocal dependence of Geist and of such individuals. Partly, this is because I feel I need to stand in opposition to a tradition that has tended to read Geist as though it were a Cartesian subject, only sort of more comprehensive. But understanding self-consciousness still in a recognizably Cartesian way and saying, look, the fundamental subject of that is not us individually or even collectively, but is this super subject. And I know you're not doing this, but you know what I'm talking about in the tradition. Whereas I take it that one of Hegel's fundamental insights is that self-consciousness isn't the sort of thing Descartes talked about at all. It's fundamentally a social achievement, a matter of being able to commit yourself a normative, it's a normative status. And I would also point out that in sort of starting my story from the side of consciousness, I'm following the phenomenology, which begins with consciousness and works its way up to self-consciousness, looks at agents' actions by self-conscious individuals, and only then moves on to spirit. Sebastian is talking about how things look when you get there. I'm telling the story following along in Hegel's way of telling the story. Now, one of Hegel's typical complaints about his predecessors is Einseitigkeit, one-sidedness. Yes, there was something to what they said, but they didn't see it was just one side of a coin. That's the form of the complaint Stein is making against me, saying, well, you're Einseitigkeit emphasizing consciousness, and I want to make the counter complaint. We both want to have both of them in view. I think everything Sebastian is saying about Geist is correct, except for the thought that you aren't entitled to say those things at the end of the day if you take the path that I'm taking. Geist is indeed what self-conscious subjects truly are. It's us as normative creatures. And all of our norm-governed doings and institutions. Geist is what we truly are. It is our truth. And we and it are constituted by our recognizing each other. That's our certainty. Certainty and truth, Hegel puts in play as terminology already in his introduction for the subjective and objective aspect. And in the introduction, he puts us on notice that we want to understand self-consciousness as truth and its certainty as aspects of one unitary phenomenon. The particular living organism becomes a normative subject by partaking in an always already up and running normative community, but the sum total of our norm-governed activities and institutions, Geist, is also produced by what individuals do, by their actual attitudes and practices. In a slogan that's particularly important to me, something that's important enough to Hegel that he quite unusually repeats this slogan within a couple of pages, he says, Sprache is the Dasein of Geist. Language is the concrete existence of Geist. It's the medium of recognition. In one sense, it's prior to speakers. We always come into a language. On the other hand, it's our practices, practical attitudes, and actual performances, us as individual speakers, that make the language what it is, that determine conceptual contents. Langue and parole are two aspects of one phenomenon. They stand in relations of reciprocal presupposition with one another, and that's the way I think we should think about, that's the model, I think, that Hegel recommends for us thinking about Geist. Yes, that's Sprache. I mean, I say it's a model because, you know, our social institutions are not purely linguistic, though that articulates them, but the model is language and the activity of individual speakers. And it's true, I follow Hegel in thinking of, in approaching this from below, from Anerkennung. One could approach it from above, from the Bildung, by which individual subjects become acculturated and get into it, but we're going to the same place. Let me just close by saying there's a related complaint that I'm more nervous about, sort of the justice of. Here it seems to me we can accept that there are these two perspectives and necessarily two perspectives on Geist and self-conscious individual subjects. Hegel complains about all of his predecessors as using meta-categories that he characterizes as Verstand, taking Kantian understanding as his slogan for them, and recommends, the way he characterizes his own meta-categories, ways of thinking about categorical meta-concepts, as Vernunft. That's the dynamic conception that involves this new way of thinking about determinateness and so on. And there is a sense in which I'm trying to reconstruct the metacategories of Hegelian Vernunft using raw materials drawn from Kantian Verstand. And insofar as that's true, that's something Hegel would have insisted was impossible, that what one needed to make a jump, a gestalt shift, in order to get to Vernunft. And I would say, well, you know, let's look and see how much of Vernunft I've managed to reconstruct. But I am sensitive to the justice of the objection that there's something suspect methodologically about trying to reconstruct Vernunft using basically the conceptual raw materials of Verstand. I mention this because I think it's a cognate worry to the one, though you didn't put it this way, to the one that you have.
Would you say that one needs Vernunft in order to comprehend this unique causality of Geist in the sense of this simultaneous interplay of the particular individual consciousness and the universal dimension of Geist? Would you say that one needs the method of speculation or of Vernunft in order to comprehend this, and that Verstand that Kant relies on is ultimately inadequate for grasping this, or would you differentiate this?
No, I would agree with that. What I'm interested in is sort of the fine structure of that Vernunftig understanding of discursive practice and normativity. Mm-hmm.
To go back to the realism-idealism issue for a second, whether you would accept the following story, because I agree with almost all of your story. I just think there's an issue with the point that Sebastian started with, your claim that the sort of objective world doesn't change at all or something along those lines. It's supposed to be a sort of core realist point. And I'm wondering if, you know, when you make this switch from starting out with basic reference, like having to do with copper, then you move up to the ideal senses as the reference, whether what you really should be doing is talking about how the objects themselves change. I mean, I know you're not a huge fan of that description in the introduction, but I wonder if you can kind of get around or fit into your richly nuanced project a shift in the kinds of objects as we go through this phenomenology, from thinking about basic facts that we can make assertions about as ordinary objects like copper, to taking the objects to be other individual living beings, to actions themselves, to communities, that those are the objects. And once you see kind of the way that those are referred to or what kinds of objects they are, then it makes sense to think of those as kind of ideal senses. We don't have to go kind of keep copper and these ordinary objects as our kind of basic reference point, but we can sort of see the world that we're referring to as altering as we move through these shapes. And I don't think this is actually a challenge to your view. I just sort of want to know how you would fit it in, because there's a lot of ways, places in Hegel where he uses kind of evaluative vocabulary to talk about how we're putting the merely sensible world in its place, that the merely spatiotemporal is getting demoted to this lower level as we kind of start talking about issues of normativity and community and action. So I wonder if that is a way out of the kind of frustration over realism versus idealism that would be amenable to you.
I think I want to make some distinctions here. I mean, you said I wasn't a fan of the bits at the end of the introduction where he talks about the emergence of the new true object, or says, look, because of the intimate relation between a knowing and its objects, when the knowing changes, so does its object. And specifically on that point, I want to say, no, it's not that I'm not a big fan of those passages. I think they've been radically misunderstood, that the change, the emergence of the new object is a change in the status of the normative status of the object from its being to consciousness what things are in themselves, to its being to consciousness merely an appearance of what things are. The new object that appears, it's the same, you know, when we discover we were wrong about copper, what changes is the status of that copper conception we've got from being to consciousness, the way we take things really to be, to our realizing, well, there may be some truth to it, but it's an appearance of some other reality. Now, that isn't saying, as it were, that the copper out in the world is changing, that's a change in the status to us. Now, I wanted to make a distinction. As we go through the consciousness chapters, we learn more about what's implicit in our conception of the objective world. So instead of conceiving of it as immediate, instead of conceiving of it as essentially observable, instead of conceiving of it as consisting in atomic facts, we come to see that we're implicitly all along committed to a much more holistic view of it, that the notion of facts is intelligible only in a context in which they stand in law-like relations to one another. So our conception of the world are the categories that we're using to become conscious of it develop in that way. That's all intelligible as the revelation of how things were all along. We recollect that history, and it's as our realizing that implicitly we were all along treating it as an organically unified world articulated by lawful relations. And we come to realize that conceiving, applying any of those categories, conceiving of the world in any of those ways is something that's intelligible only in a context in which we think about us as referring, classifying, asserting, and inferring and explaining. And so if we really want to understand that conception and the world that it's a conception of, we've got to think about those discursive activities of ours, so we're off to self-consciousness. None of that, I think, needs involve the picture of copper as changing. Our conceptions do, and sort of metaphysically challenging idea is that when we've become fully self-conscious of how this process works, we realize that the very idea of our having an adequate conception of copper is unintelligible, depends on false commitments, but that the way things are sort of in the vicinity of copper, we found out a lot more about, and our determinate concepts incorporate a lot more of the way things really are. But we have to get past thinking of all that as somehow shining more light on something that's sort of there in the Kant-Frege Verstand determinate sense.
Circling back to a comment that you made maybe 40 minutes ago now about absolute knowledge at the end of Phenomenology of Spirit, I was wondering if there's any sense in which from the standpoint of your program, you could endorse an idea that's in any sense connected to it. I'm thinking, going back to a really early essay of yours, I think Freedom as Constraint.
Constraint by Norms.
Freedom as Constraint by Norms. You talk about, I'm not sure if that's the first place, but that's one of the first places that I've encountered the distinction that you make between identifying an event as just an event or versus a free action, in terms of basically in terms of whether or not that the agent is part of a participant within a kind of recognitive community. So we're apt to if we're apt to describe that event in terms of some kind of causal story, then not. But if we're apt to translate it, then perhaps this event is an action or something along those, botched it horribly, but something along those lines. But it was this idea of translation. I'm wondering if it's conceivable to imagine a language, a kind of meta language, into which all of our social practices could be translated into, or perhaps as a kind of a regulative ideal. If say in the evolution of Geist, you can at least at the end conceive of a meta language or a set of social practices that would be, in some sense, historically constituted, though universal enough to, comprehensive enough to include something along those lines. Is that even an intelligible idea on your account?
There's a couple of issues that you're raising, I think. So one is, I mean, Hegel is the origin of our sort of distinguishing things that have natures from things that have histories. And the idea that you're treating something as a thing that has a history if you translate it, that this is a way of trying to make contact with Davidson, Quine, and so on, bring them into conversation with this tradition. I think Hegel's picture is that you treat something as having history by recollecting it, by turning its past into a history, that is, exhibiting it as expressively progressive, as the cumulative process of making explicit something that's implicit, of expressing it. That's a richer notion than sort of Davidsonian translation, but that's the way you treat something that can talk, or anyway, something that is geistig, is by recollectively recognizing it. And that's very different from explaining it in lethic modal terms. Other question, anything left of absolute knowing? Well, there's decisive advances in our self-consciousness that consist in our having more adequate meta-conceptions, more adequate understandings of what we're doing in talking and what we're implicitly committing ourselves to by doing that. I don't think that any such knowing can be absolute in the sense of being final, once and for all, not subject to supplementation, alteration, and so on. Hegel thought that, but and not for no reason, but not right, I want to say, by his own lights.
I completely agree with your take on it, that actually, so we are talking about some kind of retrospective approach, right? So especially when it comes to Hegel's philosophy of history. But at the same time, so Hegel tells us that there are some rational patterns, and this is basically what has to be discovered. In this sense, so I'm closer to what Sebastian was saying, that actually, so this Geist, so this notion of Geist and concept of Geist becomes really very important, because so what we are trying, or what Hegel tries to rediscover, so this is actually that is already present there. And in this sense, so this kind of objective content, you call it so conceptual content, right? So to some extent, it's already there. It's already kind of objectified there. And then so this discovery is rediscovery, so a recollection rather than a kind of implication of something, things.
So the final word.
Yes, I mean, my Hegel wants to be entitled to say that too.
Well, thank you, everybody, and thank you very much, Professor Brandom, for your wonderful contributions today.